speaker is Laura Hurdle from the Children's Hospital Oakland Research Institute, and she's going to talk to us about human cytomegalovirus tropism, tango or contradance.
Okay, first of all, of course, I would like to thank the organizer for inviting me to talk. I was here at this symposium last year. It was a total blast. I really enjoyed myself immensely, so I'm looking forward to this year too. So my talk will be on one of the topics of my lab at CORI, which is actually CMV tropism. Since I will be the first of a few talks on CMV, I thought I might give you just a quick, very quick overview on CMV to bring you up to speed. So CMV is, of course, a herpes virus. It's a ubiquitous virus, so it can be found in the majority of the population. It is usually acquired in early childhood, and it's not a problem for immunocompetent individuals. Actually, most of us might have CMV, and we are happy and healthy, so no problem in there. But it can be a huge problem for immunocompromised individuals, and by those, I mean mostly fetuses and transplant recipients, although also AIDS patients were heavily affected before heart. So in these cases, CMV, and in particular CMV tropism, it can be really life-threatening. So I will spend just a little bit more time on the CMV virion. This is actually an EM picture I acquired of a real virion. This is obviously a cartoon. And this is to illustrate the complexity of this virion, which is basically the same or similar with all herpes viruses. So the genome in here is contained within a capsid made of proteins. This is surrounded by a layer of amorphous proteins, which is called the tegument, and everything is then contained within an envelope. So both inside here, as well as on the envelope, there's a lot of proteins, mostly of viral origin, but there's also some cellular proteins that become contained within the virion. And all these proteins are likely, or we know, they have a role in determining viral tropism. So as I said, the virus is usually acquired in early childhood. The entry route is thought to be the mucosae, and then the spread occurs through blood, and it's strictly cell-associated, so you don't have free virus released into the blood. Like all viruses, CMV becomes latent. The major site of latency for CMV is the bone marrow, in particular hematopoietic progenitor cells, and from there it can then reactivate, which means it produces new infectious viral particles, which can then be spread through body fluids like urine, saliva, and blood. So you understand that just from this lifestyle, it's clear that the virus has to interact with a lot of different cells. And this mechanism of life is very different from that of other herpes viruses, like, for instance, herpes simplex, which infects basically epithelial cells and neurons. So again, because of this lifestyle, like all herpes viruses, CMV is considered to be incurable because it's actually never eliminated from infected individuals. So in terms of tropism, as I said, CMV is a bit different than other herpes viruses because its tropism in vivo is unusually broad. Basically, all cells, all cell types have been found to be infected or infectable in vivo, with a few exceptions, which are actually the lymphocytes and polymorphonuclear leukocytes. So the question that I'm working on and many other people same are is how does it do it, okay? And the reason why tropism is so important is basically both for basic science, because this can help unravel new cellular processes, and near and dear to the NIH and funding for translational science. The idea here would be to find a new antiviral that would reduce the disease burden by limiting virus spread, so limiting basically the spread of virus to all these multiple different organs. And by this, I mean both during primary infection, although those are usually asymptomatic, so not a big deal, but mostly during latency, where reactivation from latency in particular patients and subsequent spread of the virus in an immunocompromised patient is actually life-threatening. Also, of course, there's the issue of a vaccine, which has received new attention very recently. And to find a vaccine that actually works, it's important to find the determinants of virus spread and how the virus can enter into new cells to be able to inhibit that via, of course, antibodies, for instance. Okay, so for quite a long while, it was thought that actually how does the virus get access to so many different cells was through what I call a tango strategy, which means you have basically one partner and one way to dance. And what was that? It was basically by attaching to cell surface proteoglycans, which are ubiquitous. So the virus attaches to these proteins, which are found on most cells. And then after that, it was shown that the virus could actually fuse its envelope, which is made of lipids, with the plasma membrane on the cell. So lipid-lipid fusion, that would allow the capsid to be released as naked capsid within the cell, tracks along the cellular microtubules into the cytoplasm, reaches the MTOC, and then deposits the genome into the nucleus. Once it's in here, transcription starts and infection begins. So these appear to work fine with the cells that were used at the time, which were mostly fibroblasts. These cells are highly permissive to infection, but by particular strains of CMV. And at that time, AD169 was one of the major strains used in the lab. This is an attenuated laboratory-adapted strain. It was purposely attenuated because it was used as one of the first live vaccines. So this virus has been highly adapted to grow in fibroblasts, has lost a lot of its genes, and it indeed enters fibroblasts by fusion at the plasma membrane. So this worked perfectly fine, but then when the same strain was used on other cells, like in particular endothelial and epithelial cells, which are highly relevant to pathogenesis, basically these cells remain resistant. So AD169 could not, and still cannot, infect this type of cells. So it was clear that that mechanism was not the major mechanism or the only mechanism available. So a new model came up, which is the one which I call it the counter dance. Basically, in counter dance, you are always yourself, but you have to dance with multiple different partners. So you keep on changing the partners, and your strategy of approach with different partners is going to be different. So this came with the development of the so-called endotheliotropic strains. There's more than one, so it's different than AD169, which is a single strain. These strains all of a sudden became available, and the singularity about these strains was that they were capable of infecting endothelial cells. So these strains actually opened up a completely new way of looking at CMV tropism, and nowadays it's thought, although it has not been completely shown, that different CMV subpopulations are actually likely to exist in vivo, and each of these different subpopulations have slightly different genomes, and therefore they also have slightly different abilities to infect different cell types. So this is obviously a DNA virus, so it's not mutating as fast or as rapidly as RNA viruses, so we are not in the scenario that Carla showed this morning, but it's actually likely that if you isolate CMV from a specific organ or a specific tissue, that virus is going to be slightly different than the same CMV isolated from a different body site. So basically now the view is that there's actually three players in CMV tropism: the producer cell type, where the virus grows initially and where it gets its envelope protein as well as its tegument protein; the virions per se, which are one of the main determinants, of course, because they have the big DNA, and so they encode the different tropism proteins; and then the recipient cell type, which can also dictate what pathways are allowed to the virus and what pathways are not. So clearly in here you have an interplay of viral and host factors, and in my lab we are interested in both, with a particular focus on the host. So just a little view about the genome. So the genome, as I said, is linear DNA and is huge. So it encodes for more than 200 open reading frames. New ones are being found continually, and many of these actually have a known function, mostly are thought to be immunomodulator or indeed tropism mediator. So there's still quite a bit to find there. So talking about the producer cell type, this has been actually the origin of these different strains. So basically, when you pick up a patient isolate from an infected individual, that virus has to be grown somewhere and amplified to get stocks to be used in the lab. So originally, it was mainly amplified on fibroblast, and then subsequently, in more recent year, endothelial cell culture became more established and more available, so people started propagating this virus on endothelial cells. And when you do that over multiple passage rounds of propagation, you get the endotheliotropic strains, and I put them up here because I will mention some of these later on. Basically, TB40E was one of the strains which was then cloned as bacterial artificial chromosome and called BAC4, TR another strain, PH and VR. And the fibroblast-adapted strain, these one are the most commonly known strains. Everybody was using these up to maybe 20 years ago, so 8169, Town and Toledo. These two are the live attenuated vaccine. This was considered to be more virulent, but later on it was found that that virus is highly mutated too. So if you propagate the virus in different cells, different producer cells, you get different strains, and these strains basically differ. As I told you, have slightly different genomes, and in that you have some deletions, insertions, and inversions, which are relatively easy to find because you align the genomes of multiple strains and you will see if pieces are missing. What's a little bit harder to find is single mutations, which could be interspersed throughout the genome and could hit open reading frames with unknown, whose protein has a known function. So they may be relevant to tropism, but they're much harder to find. So again, the viral determinants, of course, affect the proteins that are synthesized by the virus. Many of those end up on the envelope as well as on the tegument, and therefore, this can affect the way that the virus uses to enter the cells and start productive infection, which is basically requires expression of the immediate early genes. If you don't have IE expression, productive infection is basically halted. So in our lab, as I said, we're looking at both the viral and the cellular determinants. And very recently, three complexes, or actually it's always the same complex, but it has different players, have been identified as being determinants of viral tropism for endothelial and epithelial cells. So this complex is composed of GH and GL, and this is one of the simplest minimal complex that is exposed on the membrane. Now, this complex is usually paired with the GO, and this was one of the initial complexes that were known to be on the envelope of CMV. Recently, the new proteins, 128, 130, and 131A have been found, and these triplets actually couples with the GH and GL instead of GO, giving rise to a completely different complex on the envelope. This is important because initially, these two complexes which are found on the surface of AD169 were shown to mediate entry by fusion at the membrane. By contrast, this new complex was actually shown to be required for entry by endosomal uptake of virions. This area is currently under quite a bit of research-intensive efforts to figure out how the virus actually does it and which components of this complex are required. The presence of the complex, though, appears to be absolutely required for entry through that pathway. So basically, you can think of a table like this where initially AD169 and Tau have only this complex. They can enter very well into fibroblast, but not into this endo and epi, while if you have this other complex, like in BAC4, this opens the way to, this allows you to access multiple different cells, not just fibroblasts, but also these two type of cells. And since BAC4 is supposed to have both complexes, but this is absolutely required for entry, we can infer that actually epi and endothelial cells, the major entry pathway in these cells is by endocytosis. A virus that enters through this mechanism cannot actually access these cells. So it's unlikely that these cells allow entry through direct fusion. This goes towards explaining the fact that it's not just the virus, but it's also the recipient cells that dictates which way the virus gets in. Now, I would like to switch gears a bit and just talk a little bit about dendritic cells. These are my beloved cell type in the lab. And these cells are very important for CMV pathogenesis. So I'm just going to give a short overview on DC in general. They come from hematopoietic progenitors. CD34 are called stem cells. They are much more, their differentiative capacity is much larger than CD14 cells, which are the monocytes. From here, both these cell types actually enter the bloodstream, reach the periphery, which is the mucosae and the skin. Mucosa, I remind you, is main enterocyte for CMV, and in here they reside as immature DC. Their main job is to capture and sense pathogens. Once they sense danger, they capture a pathogen, they will migrate through the efferent lymph, reach the lymph node where they reside as mature DC. These are the most efficient professional antigen-presenting cells because they can activate naive T lymphocytes. So in terms of CMV, these progenitor cells are major sites of latency, while the immature DC can be sites of entry as well as reactivation from latency. The mature DC may be sites of dissemination, while mature DC have been shown to be sites of immunomanipulation. So dendritic cells are kind of important, crucial, actually, for CMV pathogenesis, although they are not one of the major targets affected by cell lysis. So in the dermis as well as in the mucosae, you have two different types of DC. On the surface, so your epidermis, is the upper layer, contains DC which are stained in here, so these blobs, and these are called Langerhans cells, while down deeper into dermis, there are other types of DC which are called dermal or interstitial DCs. Okay, these are not the only two types of DC, but they are the main populations found, mostly the Langerhans cells on the mucosa, the surface of the mucosa. These sites are also important because recently there has been a renewed interest into injecting vaccine by intradermal administration, and I'm particularly focusing on this because the live attenuated vaccines that were developed for CMV and that are now somewhat up on a limb, they were administered basically intramuscularly. So they may not have actually targeted the important cells to develop an appropriate immune response, which would be found instead on just under, basically, the skin. So this is an idea that I have, that probably the site of injection of new vaccines could actually revamp the use of this live attenuated vaccine by giving you the desired responses. You just need to know more about how this virus can interact with these cells, the DC in the skin. So we have two ways of working. So it's hard, of course, to work with DC in vivo because you don't have a lot of volunteers in there that will give their skin for CMV. So basically, we use in vitro models to derive these DC types. I'm not going to go through this extensively, but basically, if you pick up CD34 progenitor cells from cold or peripheral blood, you can differentiate them into immature ILC, Langerhans cells, which can then be matured by exposure to LPS and CD40 ligand. These are the much more common and widespread used to derive DC cells in culture, which comes from monocytes, which can be derived into monocyte-derived DC, thought to be analogs of dermal DC. So these ones are on the epidermis, and these ones are found in the dermis. These ones are the ones that have been mostly used for CMV research. And here is the morphology at the end of the tissue culture. So very different. LC grow in large clusters in suspension. You can see the little hairs in here, while the MDDC do not cluster and they are mostly round, and they mostly separate from each other, although they cluster a bit. The nuclei are very different. Polylobulated in his case, regular round nuclei in here. So. And again, most of the literature, as I said, has been focused on the MDDC, the immature monocyte-derived dendritic cells, and currently many papers have come out showing that these three genes that make the most complex five-protein envelope on the complex envelope are actually required for CMV infection of DC. So if you look at current reviews and current literature, these proteins are now considered to be DC, pan-DC determinants. But experimental data are highly restricted to IMDDC, which is a specific type of DC. And And as I said, this is basically focusing only on this type of DC and completely ignoring the Langerhans cells. So when I was still in Ed's lab at Stanford quite a long time ago in 2003, I had looked at the other type of DC, which is the Langerhans cells. The immature LC was shown to be poorly permissive. So in here, you have LC infected with TB4TE, endotheliotropic strain, still, you know, very, very little infection. While by contrast, the maturation did increase the susceptibility. Clinical-like strains like these, which are endotheliotropic, were more infectious than the lab-adapted strains, but AD169 was still infecting 15% of the MLC. So this strain does not have the three DC tropic proteins in here. It only has this complex. So my question was, are these proteins really pan-DC determinants? Are they absolutely required for infection of all DC or not? So we set up to test that. And to do so, we used quite a bit of different strains. Basically, the AD169 and TAN, which had GH, GL, and GO, TR, which has the full-blown pentameric complex, and then GH and GL. GO, by these strains, appears to be retained intracellularly and doesn't make it onto envelope. So this is a different, again, combination of complexes. And then BAC4, which has basically everything. So it has GH, GL, GO, and the pentameric complex. So we used these strains to infect ILC, MLC, and RPE. RPE were, okay, and we measured the percent of cells expressing the I1, I2 proteins as a measure of susceptibility to infection. This is a hallmark of productive infection. So we really wanted to know not just if the virus gets in, but if can it start productive infection. Of course, the RPE were used as control, and this one were my test. So in epithelial cells, here you see two different MOIs, percentage of IE and the viruses in here. The BAC4 seemed to be able to infect, although not to high percentages, but it was still okay, and the MOI actually increased the percentage of infected cells. TR seems to be basically very similar, so it could get in, while AD169 and TAN were basically unable to start productive infection. And these fit the literature, considering that here I just add the virus to the cell, so I don't use any trick to enhance infection like centrifugation, which has been used in quite a bit of the published papers. MLC in here has a different pattern. BAC4 seems to be infecting reasonably well, TR a bit less, but again, AD169 and TAN can do as well as BAC4. So from here, we concluded that UL128 and 131A are not essential. So they may be helping, but they are certainly not essential, while GO, which is lacking from this strain, may indeed be helpful, although even GO is not absolutely necessary. While ILC remain, again, completely or basically non-permissive, irrespective of the viral strain use. So we then did another trick using the strains available. Basically, AD169 has been cloned also as bacterial artificial chromosome, and the missing genes were repaired, so one of the genes was repaired. And since each of the genes is independently required to make this complex, if you knock down one, you lose the complex completely. So AD169 has a mutation in 131, and this protein is therefore not functional, and hence the entire complex is not available. So in the back, they repair the mutation in 131. This virus is called BEDAR, and this is an AD169-derived virus that has the complex put back. The other virus that we used was actually a derivative of BAC, which has UL128 mutated, and therefore the genome is that of BAC, but it lacks the three proteins in there. We tested this again on all three cell types, and on epithelial cells, this goes up all the way up to 100, but I just wanted to keep the same scale all through. So it's clear that UL128 to 31A are required for infection, because see, this one out of two viruses. This one is lacking 128, and this one is AD169, so very big difference. But again, in MLC, you don't see much of a difference, so these proteins are helping infection, of course, but they're not absolutely required. And the ILC still remained non-permissive, depending a little bit of variability depending on the donor of the cell. So again, the presence of these proteins, what we could conclude is that it's actually helping, but it's not absolutely necessary, while ILC remained completely resistant. So we are currently working on this because so far we could not find any strain that can infect this ILC. And we don't know what the source of this remarkable resistance is and if the virus can actually reach the nucleus. So what we're currently working on is actually to try to figure out where does the virus get stuck. And this is very preliminary data we have where we stain these cells with Herxt, as well as with a PP150, which is a protein that remains tightly associated with capsids. And I don't know if you can see, this was supposed to be a movie, but you see a particle in here which is very close to the nucleus, and another one in here which has already reached the nucleus. So it's clear that the virus can actually, so this is 5 hours post-infection, so the virus can actually get in and reach the nucleus, meaning that the entry pathways are not the problem in this type of cells. So we're now interested in knowing what is the problem. So I said that already. So basically, the block in ILC infection appears to be post-entry. And we seem to be in the same situation where the field was about 20 years ago, before the arrival of these endotheliotropic strains that open up a completely new way of looking at CMV tropism. So we are wondering whether these actually ILC represent a whole new way of dancing, which doesn't have anything to do with entry, but it's more related to the nuclear deposition of the genome. And again, this I want to thank the CORI, my new institute, funding the two members of the lab, Alvin and Marie. Alvin is my right hand right now, beloved technician who is going to leave for grad school soon. So I thought I used this occasion. I'm sorry for spamming, but I'm looking for a new talented technician. So if you are so inclined, just contact me or email me. Thank you very much.
This is very nice talk. Part of the reason I think that CMV doesn't infect lymphocytes is the CMV promoter, the major media early promoter, is silenced by chromatin. Have you checked in the ILC if the major media early promoter is silenced? Could that be part of the post-entry block?
Yeah, yes, of course. See, we haven't looked at the, because the problem is that I still don't know if the viral genome is actually into the nucleus of the ILC or not. Yes, it's true, but it has been shown that actually when you transiently transfect plasmids containing the IE promoter, that is usually not in the same state as the promoter within the genome. So there has been cases where the promoter from a plasmid is much more active and less coated by chromatin than the one on the genome. So I would like to do it with the genome, and transfecting the whole batch into DC is a real nightmare.
Hi, Laura. That was great. I have a more general form of Lior's question, which is, one way of getting cues from your dance partner is not only cell biological, but also epigenetic. I mean, it could be, silencing of a particular promoter. It could be some general change. I mean, ants, it turns out, the different kinds of ants, casts, have different epigenetic marks. So I'm wondering about CMV.
Yes. Yeah, we actually have, there's actually somebody in the institute that works on epigenetics, and what we were really interested in is the fact that there seems to be quite a bit of the donor-to-donor variability, which kind of hints towards the epigenetic factors as well as genetic, okay, but the both combines. So, we are actually thinking of doing that in collaboration with this other PI, but as I said, I haven't yet determine if this thing is into the nucleus or not. So that's what we are working now. Yeah.